Welcome to Electron Online. Now we've seen vector notation in the x, y, and z coordinates, the Cartesian coordinate systems, but it sometimes makes more sense to use spherical or cylindrical coordinates. So here we're going to start by looking at spherical coordinates. And so we have the x, y, z space, the three-dimensional space. We take any arbitrary point in that space, this is the point right here, and we have a vector drawn from the origin to that point. Now, of course, in vector notation, we realize that vectors can be moved to any location as long as the length of the vector and the orientation of the vector don't change. Nothing changes about the vector, so there's no requirement to have a vector start at the origin. You could move that vector r and move it anywhere in space. As long as the same length, same direction, it's still the same vector. But it does make a sense when we start working out problems that by standard notation, we simply take the origin of the vector, the position vector r, because essentially r stands for the position vector. Well, we simply start with the tail at the origin. It just makes sense as a reference point. It normally doesn't have to be that way, but we simply do that so that things make a little bit more sense. So notice we have three components. We have the length of the vector r. We have the angle along the xy plane relative to the x-axis. We call that the angle phi. And then we have the angle to the vector r relative to the z-axis. So notice that here we have the vector r. It can be positioned in any direction. It's simply the angle from the z-axis to the vector r. No matter which way vector r is pointed, that angle is called the angle theta. And then if you see the projection of the vector r onto the xy plane, which is this dotted line right here, so we essentially, if we have light shining from above, from the z-axis, from a point in the z-direction along the z-axis, straight down, then the shadow of the r vector would be this line right here. And you can see that the angle of that line relative, that's the projection of the r vector onto the xy plane, from that line to the x-axis, that angle right here is considered the angle phi. So we tend to represent everything in space in spherical coordinates in terms of how far away from the origin, that's the magnitude r. That point, if we draw a vector from the origin to there, and that line, the line between the z-axis and that vector r, that angle is theta, and then the projection of r onto the xy plane, the angle between that line and the x-axis is the angle phi. Now, how do we represent the distances? So notice if I take this point right here and I project it straight down onto the xy plane, this point right here, there's a certain distance away from that point to the xy plane, that's the z axis, and so that's the distance in the z direction from the xy plane to the point. Then we have the distance from that point, the projection straight down to the xy plane, from there to the x-axis, and the distance from there to the y-axis. Notice that this represents the y-coordinate of that point. This represents the x-coordinate of that point, the distance from the origin to the point along the x-axis where that point is located, the distance from the origin to the point along the y-axis where that's located. So here we have the y-distance, we have the x-distance, and now we have the distance from the xy plane up to that point in the z-direction. So we have three distances. This is the x distance, oh sorry, this is the y distance, this is the x distance, this is the z distance. And how do we represent those? Well, take a look. Here we have the equations, but where do those equations come from? Well, first of all, let's take a look at this one right here, z, this distance right here. Notice if this angle here is theta, then this must be theta as well, because notice that this is parallel to the z-axis, those are alternate interior angles. You can see then that this is adjacent to the hypotenuse. So we see a right triangle right here. This, by the way, is a right angle. Oop, let me try to draw a right angle in the right way. There you go, there's my right angle. So there we have a right angle triangle, and we can see that this is the hypotenuse of that triangle. This is the adjacent side of the angle theta, so therefore this distance z is equal to the hypotenuse r, the magnitude is r, and times the cosine of the angle theta. So z is equal to r times the cosine of theta. Now, if we take this and we project that straight down at the xy plane, what is this distance right here? Now, notice that this is opposite to the angle theta. So again, we have the hypotenuse of the triangle, and we multiply times the sine of theta because it's the opposite side to the angle theta. So this distance here is r sine theta. Now relative to that, we have another right triangle. Where's our right triangle? Well, let's see here. Right triangle, that would be this side right here. This here is a right angle. And notice that here we have the angle phi, which is adjacent to this side right here. And now we need to know this side right here, which is opposite the angle phi. And that, of course, is the y distance. So we say y is equal to this, essentially. All right, so where's the hypotenuse? The hypotenuse is here. Here are the two sides. The x distance and the y distance are the two sides. This is the hypotenuse. And so to find this distance, we take the hypotenuse and multiply it times the sine of this angle because it's this side is opposite of the angle. So it's the hypotenuse, r sine theta, times the side of the angle phi gives us the y distance right here. Hopefully that makes sense. Now we need to know the x distance right here, which is the same as this distance right here. So this here is the same as this here. So this is your x distance. And so that right here would be your x distance as well. Now notice that's adjacent to the angle phi, and we have the hypotenuse r sine theta. So x is equal to the hypotenuse r sine theta times the cosine of the angle phi because it's adjacent to the angle phi. Now we have an expression for x, y, z, the x coordinate, the y coordinate, and the z coordinate of a point in space in terms of r, theta, and phi according to these equations right here. And you can see where those equations came from. And finally, we want to be able to then express the r vector in terms of x, y, and z coordinates. And so you can say that the r vector is the x component, the y component, the z component in the x, the y, and the z direction. So how do we define the x component of r? Well, it is r projected onto the x-axis. That's this x right here. And so the x component is r sine theta cosine phi, which is right here. Then we project the r vector onto the y-axis. That's this distance, x-axis right here, which is this right here. Then we project r onto the y-axis, which gives us this distance right here, r sine theta sine phi, that goes in here, that's the y component. And then finally, we project r vector onto the z-axis, we get this distance right here, so we get r times the cosine of theta. So we have the x, the y, and the z components of the vector r. And that's how we denote the vector r in terms of the x, y, and z components. And then if you want to find the unit vector r right here, the unit vector r, we simply take r and divide it by its magnitude, which means that all the r's cancel out and you're just left with this. This is the definition of the unit vector pointing in the direction, the same direction as the r vector, from the origin to any point in space. Now what about the phi and the theta unit vectors? What direction do they point into? So let me try to show that. I need three of these markers. So let me try to show what that looks like. So notice that these three markers are all perpendicular to one another, right? There's 90 degree angles between all of them. All right, so now if I imagine that the black marker right here is the r unit vector, then the blue marker here is the phi unit vector, and the green marker here is the theta unit vector. So notice that they all are perpendicular to each other. So notice that there's a 90 degree angle between r and theta, there's a 90 degree angle between r and phi, and there's a 90 degree angle between theta and phi. So they're all kind of located like this. It's hard to draw that on the board, of course, but if you use a little bit of imagination, you can see that the theta vector points at a 90 degree angle relative to the r vector. Wherever the r vector is pointed, no matter which way it's pointed, notice that the phi vector is pointing away like this, and then the theta vector is pointing straight down. Again, there's a 90 degree angle between r and the theta unit vector. R unit vector points directly in the same direction as the r vector, and the phi unit vector points at 90 degrees away from the r vector like this. So one is down, one is to the side, and the r vector is pointing out. So phi, r, and theta unit vectors are positioned like this. And yes, we're going to develop expressions for all these unit vectors, as well as how we express r in terms of the unit vectors, how we express r in terms of x, y, and z, and how we express r in terms of theta, r, and phi. So we'll work that in a few more videos, but hopefully this gives you a good feel for how spherical coordinates work, how the R vector is defined, how the three unit vectors are defined, and how you express the x, y, and z components of the R vector in terms of R, theta, and phi. It's a good start. Hopefully that makes sense, and we'll continue in the next several videos explaining additional things about the spherical coordinates. And that is how it's done. Once you kind of figure it out, it's kind of fun. Yes, I did.
No, I mean, not anybody doing it before.
Oh, you know, probably you could. I mean, it kind of makes sense once you see it. I remember as a student, this was like Greek to me, and I don't know any Greek.
English.